I'm delighted to say choosing the golden year today is Toyah Wilcox. Hello.
Hello, and it's an honour to do this.
Well, it's our honour to have you here, absolutely.
Thank you.
We know that you have many years you could choose
yes.
from the early part of your career, but which is it you've gone for?
I think I've gone for really one of the most impressive, magical, outstanding years in music, and that's 1972.
Right, 1972. So you're quite young at that time.
I was 14 and I was beginning to be completely out of control. Mm. It was kind of my pre-characteristics before the punk movement. So in this year, Margaret Thatcher came to visit our all-girls school in Birmingham to give a speech about the future of education. And I was the school rebel. I set 5 alarm clocks under the school stage to go off during her speech, and they did. And everyone...
At different times, I hope.
At different times. It was every 3 minutes. And Margaret Thatcher just kept talking, but by the 4th alarm clock, everyone was looking at me in the room.
Now,
they knew it was me.
Why would they suspect you of all people?
By this time, I'd already seen Black Sabbath live. I'd already seen, who else, Hawkwind. I mean, I was started to go to concerts by the time I was 11, and I used to just stand at the exit doors of the venues in Birmingham and say, please, could you go round and open the exit door to the audience? Everyone did it.
Yeah.
And when I became a musician 4 years later, I did it for the kind of people that couldn't buy tickets. They didn't have enough money to see me. So we'd go into the venue and open the exit doors and let everyone in. So this was very much a kind of Birmingham thing, but I remember 1972 for my excessive self-confidence, the brilliant music, the fact I started making my own clothes, I started to become a hair model. I was a hair model for a well-known brand, Weller, and travelled the country, pretending to be much older than I was, modelling in huge venues around the country with very strange coloured hair before the advent of punk. I was just becoming the Toyah that was about to happen in 1977.
And where do you think this rebellious streak, this push into the future came from? Did it come from something in your upbringing or your experience at that time?
Well, yeah, it's everything you say. I'm not very tall. And I was always told that I would never excel to anything because of my height. And I can remember the headmistress saying very loudly, in a way that I could hear, to my parents, oh, don't worry about her, she'll find a nice husband and have lots of children. And that was it.
Yeah.
That set me off, really set me off. And it's not that I'm against husbands, children and family life. I wanted a career. And I just set about getting that career from that moment. I enrolled in a weekend drama school. I started to do drama productions at the weekend. Very, very quickly, I was doing walk-on roles at Pebble Mill, BBC, in Birmingham. And people were getting to know me to the point directors were coming to Birmingham to see me. And I ended up at the National Theatre in 1976, because I was this outlandish person on the streets of Birmingham.
Yeah, and you were an actor before you were a
yes.
musician, a professional musician.
Yes, at the time, 1976, I was the youngest member of the National Theatre, working with Kate Nelligan, lots of other luminaries within theatre, in a play called Tales from the Vienna Woods. Warren Clark was one of the stars in it as well.
What a great actor Warren Clark was.
And fantastic. A great friend
yeah.
too.
Yeah. Lovely, lovely man. So let's think about 1972 and your first piece of music from that year. What's it
Roxy
be?
Music.
Okay.
Who changed the face of music. They were so glamorous and they took the glam look to the next stage because they were so sophisticated in how they presented themselves. You had Brian Eno, who could have been third gender. You didn't quite know who and what his pronoun was, even in 1972. You had Brian Ferry, who was just a matinee idol. And then this brilliant music. And it said to me that uniqueness and individuality had a place within commercial music. So my first song is Virginia Plain.
So what's the next choice, Toyah?
Stevie Wonder, Superstition. And I chose this because I didn't really hear this until I was at the National Theatre, 1976, living in the basement of Kate Nelligan's house, Stockwell, London. And she loved Stevie Wonder and she played his albums all the time. And I fell in love with this incredible song.
So a lot of people choose Stevie Wonder, Toyah.
Of course.
No surprise. That
no
you've done
surprise.
That. Deep Purple next, I think. So what's that?
I'm very proud that I'm a girl from Birmingham. When I lived in Birmingham as a child, I wasn't so sure, but now I see this beautiful city that's evolved into a friendly, welcoming, modern city. It's absolutely special. And I grew up with heavy metal, the local bands. Now, Deep Purple aren't local, but Robert Plant, neighbour of mine, good friend. You then have Black Sabbath. And Deep Purple with the most famous riff in the world. And when I first heard this riff, I fell in love with it. This is Smoke on the Water. And I'm very proud to say that my first record label I was signed to owned the master to Smoke on the Water.
Ooh, that's not a bad thing to have in your cupboard, is it?
I know, and it's all I ever heard about when I first signed as a punk artist to Safari Records.
What was your music, your experience of the music business like in those early days?
It was very exciting. You have to add to the ingredients of a magical list of ingredients that I was youthful. I'd moved away from home. I was living on my own, which was the best thing for me. So I was pretty independent, very confident and quite wild. The punk generation were not a scared generation. So I would travel everywhere on my own, having a lovely time, seeing bands, getting to know people through fanzines, which were these kind of leaflets we all printed up. They were incredibly popular, making new friends all day long, every day. It was, for me, a very friendly culture and it embraced diversity on every level. When I was first touring, which was 1977 into 1978, going up north, it was very interesting going into venues that had a stripper before you went on stage. And no matter how I tried to say, I do not approve of this. I don't behave like that. I'm not a female like that. I called myself third gender in 1977 because I didn't want to be addressed as female. I wanted to be addressed as Toyah.
Yeah.
So to go on stage and the stripper went on before you really informed you what the audience could be like. And it was a very tough experience, very tough. But it's made me who I am today.
Well, character building, certainly.
Character building. And I soon found out as soon as I walked on after the stripper, I did not match the stripper's beautiful physical qualifications. They let you know.
But you had to grab the audience then.
You had to win the audience. And I still love that today. When I do the huge multi-artist bills, Glastonbury, Isle of Wight, to a certain extent, there's a high percentage in that audience you have to prove yourself to. And I love that.
Perfect. Now, your next choice, it's Lou Reed, Walk on the Wild Side.
Lou Reed, I mean, my goodness. At this very tender age of 14, when Transformer came out, one of the most outstanding albums of the year, with so many messages on it, my brother, who's 5 years older than me, called Kim, was already building his own cars. And we kept going off into the night with his friends in this rinky-dink car he'd built. And we'd go and watch Andy Warhol films at midnight in all the cinemas. So I started to learn about Lou Reed and alternate artists and about art and how art can be popularist. It can also be incredibly sophisticated. So Lou Reed's Walk on the Wild Side reminds me of staying up all night long in my brother's homemade car, just learning about Andy Warhol and New York.
Elton John makes the list.
Elton John, I seem to remember that Rocket Man came out around June in 1972. And the reason I remember this, by this time I was 14, my parents stopped taking me on holiday with them. And they left me on a caravan site to fend for myself. And I chose this. I thought, now I don't want to be with parents. I just want to be on my own. And it was very, very lonely. I was there for a week and didn't quite know what to do. And I turned the radio on about 5 days into this incredibly isolated holiday. and Rocket Man came on. And it was one of those light bulb moments when you listen to that lyric and the otherworldliness and this lonely Rocket Man. And it did what rock always does really successfully, and that is it tells you, you are not alone. There's a greater world out there. And for me, Rocket Man will always represent that.
You said earlier on, Toyah, that your teacher had said, oh, don't worry about her, she'll get a good husband, which was not what you wanted to hear at the time. But as time went by, you did get a very good husband, didn't you?
I have a wonderful husband. I'm married to the guitarist Robert Fripp. Robert is the guitarist on Bowie's Heroes, Scary Monsters, Fashion. He produced early Peter Gabriel. He's 77. He's been in the business a long, long time.
King Crimson, of
King Crimson, yep. Iconic band. We've been married for 37 years. We work together now. We're on tour together, Toyah and Robert. And we're touring in October, the Toyah and Robert show, which is a fond look back at Sunday Lunch, which is our social media over the last 3 years.
That's really taken off, hasn't
it's
it?
It's taken off. And this year, it's reached 120 million visits.
That's astonishing.
And we're incredibly proud of it. And it started April the 20th, the very first lockdown. I posted a 28-second video of teaching Robert how to jive. Yeah. Pretty hopeless case. And within 5 minutes, it had 100,000 responses from people saying, thank you, we're so lonely in this lockdown, and you've reached out to us. At that point, we realised, as artists, our audience still needed us even in lockdown, and we've been posting every Sunday ever since. And it's just grown and grown and grown. It's got to the point now. I was walking down Piccadilly to come here, and people going, Sunday Lunch, Sunday Lunch, Sunday Lunch, which is lovely. Lovely.
Really, you've made a connection, a huge connection, with your audience and a much wider audience as well, reaching people that, you know, maybe didn't have that much knowledge or interest before.
Oh, but definitely. I mean, I'm a kind of British artist. I've never kind of reached beyond Germany and Europe. So for me, I mean, 2021, I was in Rolling Stone's magazine, the iconic magazine, at least once every month. And it's amazing, I've released 29 albums and never been in Rolling Stone magazine. But so luckily, thanks to Sunday Lunch, they know who I am now. They certainly know who Robert is. But I've bridged so many gaps with Sunday Lunch. As you say, it's reached a greater audience.
Yeah, well deserved too. Your rock party, Toyah and Robert's rock party, all around the country in September, October, end of September, right through October. It's going to be great. You're looking forward to it?
I'm really looking forward to it. This year, Robert and I have been touring since March. As I said, we've done Glastonbury, Isle of Wight, all the really big festivals, and it's gone down a storm. On this particular tour, we are going to be playing classic rock. And I believe if you call Mozart, Bach, Chopin classic, then you can call Led Zeppelin, Black Sabbath and everyone else classic. Because 47, 50 years later, those songs are still with us. And we're going to be playing a journey through my hit singles, through Blondie, through Mark Almond, through Led Zeppelin. We're taking that audience on a party of rock music. Very upbeat, great fun, and we want people up on their feet, singing and dancing.
Oh, it sounds great. I can't wait. Have to be there, definitely. Toyah, it's been lovely to see you again. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.